Okay, so hello everyone. Welcome to Build Your First Big Data Application. In this session, I'm going to show you how you can build an entire end-to-end analytics application for batch and streaming data from scratch. And I think this is important because analyzing data allows you to drive value from your data. So it helps you to better understand your customers, to improve your products, but also to drive your revenue. So you'll see in the session how easy it is to get started building your own analytics platform on AWS. And it's going to be a hands-on session, so I barely have any slides. And I'm going to spend most of the time in the AWS console actually building the infrastructure for you on stage. My name is Steffen Hausmann, and I'm a specialist solutions architect for analytics at AWS. OK. So let's assume for a moment that we are in charge for a large taxi company in New York City. Each of our taxis is equipped with sensors that are frequently reporting, sending geospatial information back to our backends. And we are now in the position that we have to figure out how we want to use this information we are receiving to optimize the operation of our fleet. We can, for instance, monitor the revenue we are currently making and obtain notifications if the revenue dips. Or we can try to figure out which are the hotspots in New York City that are currently requesting a lot of taxis so that it would make sense to actually bring additional taxis to these spots to pick people more quickly. Right. But it would also be cool if we could analyze the data we are collecting in a more long-term oriented fashion. So not only the real-time aspect of what do we need to do now, but also take a look at a year or several years' worth of data to figure out what should we do next. Right. And this is basically the scenario I'm going to use to build an analytics pipeline to actually answer these questions for our company. So how would an architecture look like that can actually help answer these questions? First of all, we need to capture the incoming information, right? We have like tens of thousands of taxis sending data to a backend. And we need to figure out a way to ingest this data and then process it. So we'll start the journey with ingesting the data that is generated by these taxis into a Kinesis stream. And a Kinesis stream is basically just a replayable ordered log that serves as a buffer. So it's basically a way to decouple producers from consumers so that they can fail independently and that they can scale independently. Once the data is in the Kinesis stream, we'll use a service called Kinesis Analytics, which allows us to do real-time analytics on top of the streaming data. So as it turns out, any type of data you're collecting is probably noisy. And what we'll do with Kinesis Analytics is we'll filter out outliers and filter out data that doesn't make sense while it's flowing through our system. In addition, Kinesis Analytics also will help us to identify outliers. So we can monitor revenue, our incoming revenue, and then use machine learning on top of the streaming data to identify whether there is a dip in our revenue or something is out of bounds. We'll then build a real-time dashboard based out of the results we get from Kinesis Analytics. So we have this real-time engine continuously monitoring or analyzing our data. And this data is then sent to a CloudWatch dashboard for visualization purposes. So we're going to use another Kinesis stream and a Lambda function. But essentially, we're just going to have a real-time visualization of the incoming data so that we can then go ahead and create alarms and get notified in case something goes wrong. So the upper part of the architecture is the real-time component of the architecture. The lower part is now more oriented on long-term analytics of data. So there, what we are going to do is we'll take the data that has been cleaned by Kinesis Analytics and write it to S3 for long-term archival purposes. And once it's sitting in S3, what you're going to do is we're going to query the data through a service called Amazon Athena, which basically allows you to run SQL queries on top of data sitting in S3. And last but not least, I'm going to build a dashboard for long-term analytics and trend analytics of our data. So this is basically what I'm going to build. So don't be afraid if you didn't understand each particular component. I'll explain it in more detail while I'm actually building the architecture. But what's to remember is basically we have these two different lanes, one for real-time analytics of data, the other one for batch processing of data. So real-time ingestion of data and cleansing of the data in real-time, real-time visualization of data, ingestion of data and batch analytics of data, and last but not least, the visualization of data in a dashboard for long-term analytics. OK, so let's go and build. As promised, I don't have too many slides. I'll be the rest of the presentation basically in the console showing you how to actually build this architecture. So I'll start off with creating a Kinesis stream. A Kinesis stream, again, is a replayable ordered log that allows us to ingest a high-volume event stream and store it for real-time analytics. So I create a Kinesis stream. So I'm going navigating to the Kinesis console and create a Kinesis data stream. And I need to specify a name. So each stream needs to have a name. I'll call this Summit Taxi Trips. And now I'm asked how many shards my stream should have. So a Kinesis stream is made up of shards. And adding and removing shards to a stream is a way to scale the stream. So each shard can have an intake of 1,000 events per second and 1 megabyte per second in. And you can read 2 megabytes per second out of a shard and up to 5 requests per second, read requests per second to a shard. And by adding and removing shards, we can scale the throughput of our stream. So in order to help us come up with the right number of shards, there's a small calculator. And it basically asks a couple of metrics to determine what's the right amount of shards. So first of all, it wants to know what's the average record size. And in our case, we are just sending a couple of geospatial data, so coordinates and a couple of other values, so nothing large. So it'll be below 1 kilobyte, but that's 1 kilobyte is the smallest I can specify. Then it wants to know how many records are written into the Kinesis stream per second. And in this example I'm going to use, we'll have, on average, roughly 22,000 records per second that are ingested into the stream, but it can spike up to 30,000 records. So I'll specify, well, I need a stream that is capable of ingesting 30,000 individual records per second. And I have one consuming application, which leaves me with 30 shards, which seems to make sense. 30 shards, each shard can intake 1,000 events per second, which gives me 30,000 events per second. So I'll use this value and click Create Stream. And now in the background, we'll provision the infrastructure to actually host the stream for us. That takes a couple of moments, but it shouldn't take longer than a minute or so. And once that is completed, I can immediately start ingesting events into my stream. So the stream has been created. And now what I'm doing is you're not going to, I'm just replaying a historic data set from S3 into the Kinesis stream. So I've written a small Java application that takes a data set of historic taxi trips from New York City, which is available as an open data set on AWS. And it basically replays this data as if it happened in real time into the Kinesis stream. So for this demo, I'm using one EC2 instance that is replaying the data into a Kinesis stream. But for practical purposes, it wouldn't make any difference whether I have one application ingesting 30,000 records per second or if I had 30,000 producers ingesting one event per second into the stream. Wouldn't make any difference, right? So it would be, from the Kinesis perspective, would be the very same thing. Okay. Now that we're sending records to the Kinesis stream, I can start creating my Kinesis Analytics application. So Kinesis Analytics is a service that allows you to run continuous analytics on top of streaming data. I hit Create Application, and you can see that Kinesis Analytics comes in two flavors, SQL and Apache Flink. So for the purpose of this demo, I'm going to use the SQL component because it's more natural, more easy to use and to read, in particular if you're familiar with SQL. However, if you're building a real-time architecture yourself, I highly encourage you to take a look at Apache Flink. It's a very cool open source project that is offered as a managed service through Kinesis Analytics. Right. So again, the application needs a name, call it Summit Taxi Trips. And hit Create. And now that the application is created, I can connect it to the Kinesis stream where I'm already ingesting data. So I'll hit Connect Stream and simply select the stream that carries the data. I now have the option to use a Lambda function to pre-process the incoming data. So with Kinesis Analytics, I'm running SQL queries on top of my streaming data. However, in particular for ETL or transformations, it may be more convenient to have an imperative language such as Python or Node.js or whatnot, and where you can bring your own libraries to do some kind of pre-processing. So here you have the option to actually do that. The events are ingested into the Kinesis stream. They are pre-processed by Lambda and then handed over to Kinesis Analytics. I'm not going to do this for the purpose of this demo, but that's one option you have there. The service needs access to my account so that it can actually read and analyze the data. And last but not least, I need to specify a schema. Right? Eventually, I'd like to run SQL queries against the streaming data. So I need to come up with some kind of schema. And with the Kinesis stream, I can basically ingest anything I'd like. So there are no limitations what I can ingest. As long as it's smaller than 1 megabyte. So I need to have a way to tell Kinesis Analytics what's the schema of my application. And Kinesis Analytics actually helps me with it. I can hit Discover Schema. And now Kinesis Analytics reads a sample of events from the stream and tries to infer the schema for me. It claims it was successful, and it doesn't look too bad, right? So you can see we are dealing with some kind of geospatial data. It's talking about pickup and drop-off times and locations. So this is the data that is sent by these taxis. And it inferred the correct types. However, it's only looking at a sample of the stream. So the inference may not be perfect. And actually, in this case, we need to fix a couple of things. First of all, the trip ID. When I start ingesting data into the stream, the IDs are rather small. But over time, they can grow very large. Kinesis Analytics doesn't know that, so I need to change the type from integer to big int to accommodate for that. Also, the type. It thinks the type attribute can be 4 characters. It can actually be 8. So it's a good first guess, but you always need to check whether it actually matches the schema of the data you're ingesting. OK. So now I'm saving the schema, and the application is actually started. So now we are going to provision infrastructure on your behalf and deploying the application on top of that infrastructure. It's a fully managed service, so it scales automatically. It recovers from failures automatically. There's nothing on your end to really watch out for. So that's done. I can then add reference data to Kinesis Analytics, which basically means it's a static data set that you can use as some kind of lookup table if you want to enrich the events coming in. You can join the static reference data set with the streaming data that are ingested into the stream. I'm not using this for the demo, but that's another option you have. And more interestingly, I can now go ahead and write SQL queries. So I've already prepared a couple of queries, and I'll explain in a second what they actually do. So I'll copy and paste the code, and then we can see how that looks. OK. So Kinesis Analytics comes with two important concepts, in-application streams and pumps. An in-application stream is very similar to a table. It has a schema and basically like a mapping between attributes and their types. Pumps are more interesting. Pumps allow you to continuously evaluate queries on top of your streaming data. So a pump basically allows you to read data from one stream and write it to another stream through an SQL query. So it basically is a way to just continuously evaluate SQL query. It takes as an argument an SQL query and continuously evaluates that SQL query on your behalf. And this is how it looks in action. So this is the definition of a stream. It's basically just a schema telling me, well, there are a couple of attributes with their types. And here's our first query. Well, that was I didn't mean to do that, sorry. So this is our first query. And if you just look at the highlighted text, it looks like regular SQL. It actually is. So it's ANSI-compliant SQL. We just added a couple of extensions to adapt it for streaming purposes. But what does this query? Well, it inserts the result into a stream called clean trips. It then selects a couple of attributes from the input stream and has a filter clause that filters events that have a pickup and drop-off location of zero. So as I've mentioned in the introduction, the data I'm receiving is noisy, and therefore we need to filter out certain events, and this is what this query is doing, right? So a very common SQL query. The only special part is the pump. And again, the pump just takes care of continuously re-evaluating this query when your data arrives. So this is essentially a very simple filter for the application. But Kinesis Analytics allows us to do more advanced queries as well. So if you consider any downstream applications, we are ingesting 20,000, 22,000 events per second into the stream. Chances are that your downstream applications are overwhelmed by that amount of events flowing into your system. So usually what you're trying to do is you don't actually need a complete view of all of the events in your system. You want to have an aggregated view of these events. So it's sufficient to know how many trips you made per second and how much revenue you made per second. You don't want to see the revenue of each individual trip. So we want to aggregate our data, and this is what this query does, right? So it basically uses a tumbling window of size 1 second, which basically means every second there is one window, and all events in this window are aggregated. So what this query does is specifically it is grouping over these tumbling windows, and it's then counting the number of events in this window. It's counting the number of passengers in this window and the revenue that has been made during this 1 second window. And this query is then evaluated for every 1 second window as long as the application is running, right? The way I realize this tumbling window is by the step function. And the step function basically just reduces the precision of the timestamp of the event. So each event, when it's ingested into Kinesis Analytics, is timestamped. And I'm reducing the timestamp to the second. So all events that happen within the same second fall into the same time window. And if I group by this time, I'll end up with 1 second windows that I can use to run my query on top of that. Right? So this query essentially gives me an output stream called trip statistics. And this stream, instead of having 22,000 events per second, has only one event per second, right? So one aggregated event per second is ingested into this trip statistics stream. Now that we have this, we can actually run more complex analytics on top of that. I've mentioned, well, we may want to monitor our revenue and get alerted when our revenue dips. And one of the really cool things of Kinesis Analytics is we have extended the SQL capabilities by machine learning algorithms. So you can run machine learning algorithms on top of your streaming data. And the cool thing is that it's really simple to use, right? It's just a built-in function you can call. So this random cut forest with explanation function is basically an implementation of the random cut forest algorithm on top of streaming data. And by just calling this function and pointing it to a Kinesis, to an in-application stream, that's all you've got to do, right? And it's basically an unsupervised learning, anomaly detection algorithm that comes with Kinesis Analytics. So this query basically takes a look at various different attributes. The most important one is the revenue. And whenever it learns the patterns of the stream, the patterns of the events that are occurring, and generates an anomaly score that helps us to assess whether that's common data or something we should take a look at. OK. So up until now, I've only created in-application streams. And now I'd like to send this data to CloudWatch so that we can actually visualize the data and create alerts on top of these. And therefore, I need to send the data that is ingested into an in-application stream to another Kinesis stream so that other applications outside of Kinesis Analytics can actually read the data. So I'll go ahead and create a destination. I'll make it a bit smaller. I'll create a destination, and this destination is another Kinesis stream containing these anomaly scores of the incoming data. So I'll call the Kinesis stream. Summit anomaly trips. And as this is based on the aggregated data, we only will have one event per second. So one shard is more than enough to actually handle the throughput of the events that are going to be written through this stream. So I'll create the stream. And once that's done, I can connect the in-application stream trip statistics anomaly with this Kinesis stream. So all data that is written to this in-application stream will eventually end up in the Kinesis stream I've just created. I can choose different output formats, JSON or CVS. I'll use JSON. Again, Kinesis Analytics needs the permissions to actually write to my stream. So now if I hit save and continue, we again will redeploy the application, and then the data of the output of the random cut forest algorithm will eventually arrive in the Kinesis stream where it can be picked up by Lambda. Okay, so therefore I'll create a Lambda function, and the Lambda function is just basically reading the data from the Kinesis stream, convert the format so that it can be sent to the to CloudWatch for visualization purposes. So there's nothing really special with this Lambda function. It's just a glue between the Kinesis stream and the CloudWatch dashboard I'm going to build. So, oops, I'll create the function. Summit anomaly. Again, it needs permissions to write into my account. I've already prepared the function. And once that is ready, I'll show you how it looks like. OK. So the function, it's only a couple of lines. And again, basically what it does is it converts the format of the events of the Kinesis stream to the format that is expected by CloudWatch for ingesting data. So there's nothing really special. I'm just picking up events and dumping them into CloudWatch. So now that the function is there, I can connect the Lambda function to the Kinesis stream. So I hit Kinesis, pick the right stream to read from, and off we go. So now that is deployed. So what's important to understand here, a Kinesis stream is a pull-based model, right? So from a Kinesis stream, you write data into a stream, and then you regularly read from the stream to obtain the data that has been written into the stream. If you connect a Lambda function to a Kinesis stream, we will actually continuously read the data from the Kinesis stream on your behalf and call the Lambda function whenever there's new data ready. So it converts the pull-based model into a push-based model that you can use to conveniently just read batches of data out of a Kinesis stream. This is currently deployed, so we'll again provide some infrastructure that hosts these, the functionality to read the data from the Kinesis stream and call the Lambda function. But once that is ready, we can start building a dashboard in CloudWatch that is actually visualizing the data. So I'll hover over to the CloudWatch console and create a dashboard. Call Summit Anomaly Trips. And here I'll select the metrics I've been creating. So the data from the Kinesis stream is ingested into CloudWatch as a metric, as a custom metric. And I'm going to use this to build my dashboard. So down here we have the stream name, total amount, and anomaly score. I'm interested in the sum, and I'm using a high-resolution dashboard, so I'm reading data with a granularity of 1 second. And now that it's done, we can take a brief look. So here we can see the blue line is the revenue that is generated, and we can see these more or less regular patterns in the stream. And the orange line is the anomaly score, and it's currently zero because the algorithm takes some time to train, right? So it's an online learning algorithm. It's unsupervised, so it takes some time and looks. It learns the patterns of the stream, and once it's finished, it'll start providing a score, an anomaly score that we can use to determine whether we're dealing with regular data or anomalous data. It takes a moment to initialize, so I've prepared a small screenshot to show you how this looks if you let it run for some more time. So here we can see the blue line, again, is the revenue that is generated, and the orange line is the anomaly score. And what's interesting to note is these are patterns, regular patterns, changing over a day. But between every day, the patterns aren't changing that much, right? So the anomaly score, although we are seeing dips and spikes in traffic, the anomaly score stays more or less at the same level up until that moment where it spikes because there are suddenly no taxi trips at all, right? And I think that's quite impressive because I've just shown you the SQL code. It's really, it's unsupervised machine learning on your streaming data. And I looked at the data set to figure out what was going on there. And it turned out during that day where we had basically no taxi trips at all, there was a massive snowstorm in New York City. So no one was on the streets. And therefore, no taxis were running in New York City. And the random cut forest algorithm actually was able to pick that up, right? Which is not too hard because there's no traffic at all, but it can also pick up more subtle changes in our traffic patterns. Right. Okay. So this, now it's somewhat initialized. Let's move back. Okay, so this basically concludes the real-time portion of the architecture, right? We ingested data, cleaned it, ran the random cast first algorithm on top of the data, ingested it to a Kinesis stream, used a Lambda function to dump it to CloudWatch, and then build a dashboard on top of this data. Now I'm going to build the batch part of the architecture. So to this end, I'm going to write the cleaned data coming from my Kinesis Analytics application to S3. And the way I'm going to do this is by means of Kinesis Firehose. So Kinesis Firehose is a service that at the once end, at the ingestion end, looks like a stream. So we can easily send 20,000 records per second into this Firehose delivery stream. And Firehose then collects and batches the incoming events and writes large batches of events into the destination. And in our case, I'm going to use S3 as the destination. So I'll go back to my Kinesis Analytics application. And I'll connect a new destination. And this time, I'm going to create a Firehose delivery stream. The stream needs a name as well, so Summit Cleaned Trips. OK. And very similar to Kinesis Analytics, I can now specify a Lambda function as a pre-processing step. So events are sent to Kinesis Firehose. They are then processed by a Lambda function and then persisted to the destination. Again, I don't need this for this particular demo, but that's a convenient option you have. More interestingly, Firehose also allows you to convert the data into a columnar format. So what you can do here is you can convert the data that is ingested to S3 into Parquet or OLC on the fly. So this is something that's natively supported by Firehose. Those are columnar formats. And I don't have the time to go into the details. But tomorrow at 4 p.m., there is a talk in Hall 2, I think, from a colleague of mine that discusses in detail why it's a good idea to store data on S3 in Parquet and OLC, basically for performance, but also for cost reasons. So I'll just use that for now, and you can figure out the details in the talk tomorrow. One thing I need to specify is the schema of the data, right? So again, these conversions want to have some schema information so that they know how to actually convert the data. So I'm going to use a Glue, AWS Glue data catalog entry I've already prepared. And I'll show you in a second how to create these schema information by crawling the data. So I'll just use something prepared right now. And I'll show you in a second how to come up with a schema by yourself. So I specify the schema. If I'm converting to Parquet, I can only pick S3 as a destination. But in principle, you can use Redshift, Elasticsearch, and Splunk as your own destinations as well. I need to specify an S3 bucket. So I'll pick, I don't know, New York City clean trips. And now I can specify an S3 prefix. So the events that are ingested into Firehose are timestamped when they're ingested. And we can now specify a pattern how this data should be partitioned on S3. And again, this is an optimization technique that can be used to save cost and increase the performance of your queries when you're running SQL queries on top of SQL. So by default, the data is partitioned by year, month, and day. But last week, we introduced capabilities to specify your custom prefix, right? So that seems subtle, but in my world, this is a big deal because it makes things downstream much more straightforward. So I'll use that and just specify a custom prefix where I can basically specify a pattern and say, well, I want to partition my data by year, month, and day, but please make it year equals the actual year, month equals the month, and so on. Right? OK. I'll do the same thing for errors. So in case errors happen, happen during the conversion. These events are sorted out into a special prefix on S3 so that I can deal with them later. I have the option to dump the raw data to a different S3 bucket if I wanted to. So this is, in particular, useful if you use a Lambda function to pre-process the data. If you want to preserve the raw original data, you can do that as well. OK. So last but not least, you can control the buffer conditions. And the buffer conditions basically specify how often Firehose will dump the data to S3 or the respective destination. So you can control how frequently the data arrives at the destination. And usually, you're interested in having rather large buffer conditions so that you end up with large objects on S3. So usually, using just the defaults of 120 megabytes and 300 seconds is good. However, for the purpose of this demo, I'll shorten it to 60 seconds, which is the smallest period you can specify. If I weren't converting data to Parquet, I could also specify compression and encryption options. I'm not using that. And as a very last step, I need to again authorize the Firehose service to read and read data from my Kinesis stream and write it to S3. OK, I get to review my choice. And now the Firehose delivery stream is created under the hood for me. So now that that is in place, I can come back to my Kinesis Analytics application and connect the in-application stream, Clean Trips, with the Kinesis Firehose delivery stream. So I'll pick the stream and choose the appropriate in-application stream. I want to send JSON data. Again, it's fine if Kinesis Analytics writes to my Firehose delivery stream. I hit Save and Continue, and now the Kinesis Analytics application is redeployed, which takes about a minute. And the Firehose delivery stream will start buffering data for a minute. And then eventually objects will be sent to S3. So it takes a brief moment. And while we are waiting for that, I want to show you a couple of metrics of the Kinesis stream that are important to be aware of so that you don't run into throttling errors of errors caused by throttling. So we'll take a brief look at the Kinesis stream that is receiving these 20,000 events per second. And as you can see, it gives us quite some metrics. And the most important metrics are actually down here. These are metrics for read throughput exceeded and write throughput exceeded exceptions. And basically, as I've mentioned, a Kinesis stream is composed of shards. And you can only send 1,000 events per second into each shard. I've provisioned a stream with 30 shards, so I can send at most 30,000 individual events into my stream. If I try to send more, my requests will get throttled. And if that happens, it's a sign for me that I need to scale my stream because it can no longer absorb the incoming events. And these are metrics that actually help you to determine, am I under-provisioned? Is my stream under-provisioned or over-provisioned? So I highly encourage you to take a look at the read throughput exceeded metrics and the write throughput exceeded metrics because they indicate whether you have under-provisioned your stream. Another very interesting metric is the get records iterator age metric. And this metric tells you how far behind the processing is to the tip of the stream. And as you can see, in the beginning, we were doing quite well. So the get records iterator age was 0. But suddenly, it spiked to 400. And this happened because I redeployed the application. When I redeploy the application, it stops reading from the stream for some time. And when it's actually up and running again, it starts catching up. And this is what you can see here, right? So once the application was running again, it started catching up and eventually was close to 0 again. But again, this is a very important metric to track because it indicates It can tell you if your processing is falling behind and if you need to take countermeasures to actually accommodate for a too high volume stream. OK, so by now, I hope that the first data has arrived in S3, so we can quickly check. Yeah, that looks good. So we can see some data obviously has arrived. So it has been ingested 2019, February 26th at 11 o'clock. So these are UTC times. All is good. And we have our first object sitting on S3. And what I'd like to do in the next couple of minutes is, first of all, query the data through SQL, and then build a dashboard for long-term analytics. So in order to be able to query the data, again, I need to have a schema so that the query engine knows how to read and interpret the data. And the service I'm going to use to discover the schema is called AWS Glue Data Catalog. So the data catalog is a Hive-compatible metastore, and it basically contains meta information that can be used by other services such as Athena or Redshift Spectrum or EMR to obtain information where the data is located, so that you can query a table and don't need to take care of memorizing which objects belong to this table or what's the schema of these objects. So I can either manually specify the schema, or I can use crawlers to actually infer the schema for me. And that's what I'm going to do. So I'll add a crawler. Crawler name is Summit Cleaned Trips. I can now just point the crawler to an S3 bucket. So I'll choose the one we're ingesting data to. One data store is fine for now. Again, the service needs to have permissions to read the data from S3. So I'll just specify a role. I can then configure the cadence on which this crawler is run. So you can either manually run the crawler, which I'm going to do right now, but you can also specify, well, this crawler should run every hour or every day to discover new data that may have been ingested since the last run. So run on demand is fine for now. I'll create a new database. Summit Clean Trips. And I confirm. And now the crawler has been created, and I can run it to discover the schema for me. So what now happens in the background is basically we spin up a cluster of machines, deploy these crawlers. These crawlers will then read your data, sample your data, and infer the schema of this data for you, create a table in the database I've just created so that we can then use other services to query the data. Just be aware when I say it creates a table, it's just about metadata. So it's only storing the schema information and the location of the actual data. It's not about storing the actual data. It's just a connection between just a service that stores metadata on your behalf and integrates with other AWS services so it can easily query your tables or your data. So the crawler is still running, but it should complete in a second. Usually takes less than a minute. OK, so it created a table, and we can take a look. So I'll pick the right database. And here we have the table containing the cleaned data that has been written to S3 by Firehose. So if we take a look, by now, the bucket contains four objects. We have read close to a million individual events. And here is the schema that should be familiar by now of the data that has been sent to S3. And this is, by the way, exactly the way I created the schema I specified for Kinesis Firehose, right? So it Firehose integrates with the Glue data catalog, and in this way I was able to infer the schema and point Firehose to the right schema information. Okay, so now that we have a schema, we can start querying the table. So I'll use Amazon Athena to this end. So Amazon Athena is a managed Presto service, so it basically allows you to run SQL queries directly on top of the data sitting in S3. And now I guess you'll see why it's very convenient to have the schema information in Glue, because now I can just say I want to query this particular table. I don't need to know which objects are part of this table, what's the schema, and so on. It's all hidden in the schema information from the catalog. So I can basically hit select star, limit 10, and now I receive a couple of entries of the data sitting in S3. I can then come up with more. I can then go ahead and discover the data, so I can formulate more complex queries. So I can count the number of events and group it, I don't know, by the hour, let's say. So I'll do a count, and then I need a grouping, group by date and order by date. So what this basically does is it groups the data by hour and determines how many events have been received in this particular hour. And as you would imagine, in the evening, more events happen compared to during night. So at 5 a.m., much fewer text trips have been made compared to the day. Right? So now I have a very convenient way of just discovering the data. I can just run SQL queries, and I only pay for the amount of data that is scanned by these queries. So I can use S3 as a very cheap storage option, and then query the data ad hoc on demand. OK, so last but not least, I'm going to build a dashboard with QuickSight. QuickSight is our BI tool that allows you to build interactive dashboards. So I'll basically import the same data and build a dashboard to visualize it. So I'll create a new data set. And I'm going to use Athena to actually query the data sitting on S3. So I'll pick Athena as a as the source of my data. Summit cleaned trips. And now again, it's very convenient to have this centralized catalog, because now I can simply again just specify the table I'm interested in. And again, I don't need to specify any objects or any schema information. I just say I want to import this table into QuickSight. So I'll do that and hit visualize. And I can now start building my dashboard. So let's say I want to monitor the revenue and the number of passengers over time. So I pick as attributes passenger count, total amount, and I don't know, drop-off date time. And QuickSight will then come up with a visualization that it thinks makes the most sense. It just takes a second, because I ticked an option to import the data into Spice. So what happens under the hood here is QuickSight will make a call to Athena. Athena will read the data from S3, put it back to QuickSight. QuickSight will then import the data into Spice, which is our in-memory query engine, so that we can build fast and interactive dashboards. The data is cached there. And once it's imported, we can start seeing our visualizations. And it's thankfully already completed, and it's an incremental process. So we can start visualizing the data, although the import process is still taking place. So if I change this from daily aggregates to hourly aggregates, we should see these regular patterns that we've seen before, right? So we have usually a spike. You know, we have some huge spikes right here. I have no idea what's happening there. But here we can see you have usually a spike in the morning and then a spike in the evening. And during night, not too many taxi trips happen. OK, cool. So that's it from the demo part. Let me just briefly conclude. And then I'll open it up for questions. So here's basically what we've built. We started ingesting events into a Kinesis stream. We read the data from Kinesis by means of Kinesis Analytics. We cleaned the data. We ran machine learning on top of the streaming data. We built a dashboard for real-time visualization. We then dumped the clean data to S3 by means of Kinesis Firehose. We used the Glue data catalog to infer the schema information. Ran SQL queries on top of the data sitting in S3 through Amazon Athena, and then used QuickSight to build an interactive dashboard to visualize the data. So again, I've brushed over the piece where Firehose converts the data to Parquet. If you're interested in more, there's a session tomorrow. Query your data in S3 with SQL and optimize for cost and performance tomorrow at 4 o'clock in Hall 2. And that's it from my side. Please complete the survey in the app. It's basically just hit a couple of stars, and that's it. I'm already out of time, but I'll stick here for more questions if there are any. Thanks a lot.